wage war against the Lamb, but the Lamb will overcome them because he is Lord. He is the King of Kings, and all those who are with him are called chosen.
We're going to celebrate Jesus, the author of our story, our living hope, and our resurrected King.
I was lost in shame, could not get past my blame until he called my name. I'm so glad he changed me. Darkness held me down, but Jesus pulled me out. I'm no longer bound. I'm so glad he changed me.
Love me to wait to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. And my orphan heart was given in name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to when death was arrested and my life began.
Come on, church, sing it.
Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom, you faithfully bore. He canceled my debt, and he called me his friend. When death was arrested, and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over.
separated. far too wide, but from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owe, broke my chains, freed my soul, 'cause for the first time I had hope. Fallen, his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon us. One final breath of death as heaven looked away, the Son of God was laid in darkness. The battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever grew. And the ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away, His perfect love could not be overcome. And now, death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive.
Hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome.
risen. He is risen. We serve a Lord and Savior who heard that song this morning. We serve a Lord and Savior that heard your praise today. He is alive and well and ever liveth to make intercession for you. He is risen. He is risen. We praise the Lord this morning for the opportunity to declare that He is risen. On behalf of the Grove family, it is so good to have you here today. Welcome. Welcome to the family. When you're here, your family, at my house, you kick off your shoes. Please don't do that here. But I want you to feel at home. Welcome. Now you may ask, why do Christians get so excited about Easter? Why do they get so excited about this holiday? It's on my calendar, and so are many other holidays on my calendar. Why do Christians get so excited about Easter Sunday? Because there's something about that event to us that's much more than a holiday. It is a life-altering event that occurred in history. It's much more than a holiday that we commemorate honorable people, for we commemorate and praise a God who saved our souls. Amen. Christians get excited about Easter because Easter made a life-altering change in our lives. You have to wonder, what's the definition of a Christian, though? A lot of people go into communities and say, well, I'm a Christian, I'm part of a Christian nation. But per the Bible, Christian has a very specific definition. You can appreciate Christianity, you can love churches, you can appreciate all that we do as we helped people during the pandemic. The media was here earlier and we were talking to them and interviewing about how much we help this community and how much we love helping the Richmond metro area. And it's great to be able to do that, but that's just charity, which is good and needed. Christians have a deeper mission. We help others because God helped us in a way we could not help ourselves. Easter was a life-altering situation. Easter was a life-altering experience. We celebrate Easter because Easter is the climax of the story. If it were a movie, this would be the moment that in the movie there's resolution, and God brought us resolution to the problem and the conflict that has been kind of pent up and waiting for quite a while. Easter is the height of the story. What makes Easter so beautiful is what leads up to Easter. When you have a life-altering experience, you can't help but be grateful to the one that changed your life. Maybe let me say that again. When you have a life-altering experience, you can't help but be grateful to the one that changed your life. And He changed our lives. We have a lot of kids in the room, and I love that families are worshiping together. It's such a beautiful sight. This is your church. You can scream, holler, shout, run to the aisles. I don't care. They do it all the time anyway. If you have a crying baby, just pass them down the row. We're all family. We'll find a grandmother here that knows how to deal with kids. But you guys remember that when you have a life-altering event, you're eternally grateful. Okay, Toy Story 2. Woody is being captured by Al of Al's Toy Barn. The other stuffed animals are going to save their friend Woody. So they make their way to the lobby of the hotel, and they only to find that Al has got Woody in his suitcase and he is off to the airport to sell him to China. So the animated friends, they walk out, the car leaves, they can't do anything about it. So their friends see a parked yet running a Pizza Planet delivery truck. They jump in the window, Buzz goes, I'll steer. Slinky Dog, you do the pedals. Rex, you navigate the road. And all of a sudden, they realize they're not alone in the cab. For they look up to see these three soft squeeze little toys that are framed in such a... They're cute little three-eyed alien guys. Three of them are hanging from a string from the rearview mirror. And they go, ooh, strangers from the outside. And they're like, oh, no. So let's just keep on going. They hit the gas. Nothing happens. They're like, what do we do? And the aliens point to the stick shift and say, use the wand of power. So they finally, they shift in the car, and all of a sudden they go. They chase Al down the road, and all of a sudden they're left turn, right turn, left turn, right turn. And all of a sudden, the string breaks when they make a hard left, and the string with these three-eyed alien guys start flying out the window. Mr. Potato Head acts quickly. He runs to the window, grabs the string, and they're all screaming, oh. And finally they make a hard right. He uses the momentum, pulls them back in the front chair, and they all just flop. They're a little disheveled. And the three little alien guys walk up to Mr. Potato Head, and you know what they said? It is a phrase that could be heard across the world. Once you hear this phrase, you cannot get it out of your head. You cannot unhear it. Oh, you saved our lives. We are eternally. Some adults knew that one too. You saved our lives. We are eternally grateful. And they say it over and over and over again. Well, guess what? Guess what? That's how we feel about Easter. Yes. You saved our lives. You saved our lives. We are eternally grateful. That's why we like Easter. What leads up to Easter is why we're eternally grateful. Easter is the moment, the climax, the point of resolution where Jesus literally rose from the dead and lived again. That's a big astounding event, but why did he even have to do that? It's all that led up to Easter. Do not miss the backstory to that moment. We praise the Lord today for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, but it's all that led up to that moment. That makes that moment so beautiful. You understand the story that leads up to it, you will probably join me in saying, whoa, now I see why you Christians love this. Because we're eternally grateful. The story wasn't always so glorious. God created everything, and then he created mankind. He said out of all of his creation, man was the best creation. It was very good and beautiful. Man and God had a relationship and fellowship. The only part of his creation that he felt that community and that fellowship. They talked, they communed, they fellowshipped. They walked around God's creation having perfect peace. Just like every creation, including angels, creation has to be put to a test. Are you going to choose to obey me, or are you going to choose your own way? Man was put to a very simple test, and mankind chose to disobey God. And as soon as mankind disobeyed God, something was introduced into the world, and it forever broke the peaceful relationship we had with our Creator. That insertion of sin infused every person's heart and tarnished it. There's no way you can wash that sin element out of you. Now, people demonstrate that sin in very different ways. Some people exhibit their sinfulness in very horrible ways that we would just not approve of, obviously. Some people exhibit their sinfulness in very, well, we would say little ways. And in society's eyes, yes, there are some people better than others. Some people do worse things than others in society. But in God's eyes, everybody is in the same boat. No matter how you've exhibited your sin in grotesque ways, nauseating ways, or just white-collar, white-lie ways, just little ways, big ways, grotesque ways, vivid ways, small ways, hidden ways, every single man, woman, or boy and girl has that sin tarnish. We inherit it from all mankind. Every man, woman, boy, or girl that's born, every cute little child, every single person has that sin element. And we have it within our being to want to wash and clean up our act. And the way we try to pull that off is we come in a church house sometimes, or maybe we clean up our act, or maybe we give more charitable things to churches and we do good things. Now, those are really, really good. But it only changes the shell. It doesn't touch our essence. And then we read in God's word that if we have that sin tarnish, that that taint of sin throughout our being, as long as we have that true of us and don't get it washed, we must pay for that sin penalty because it's mankind's responsibility and fault. So I must pay for my sin. I want to get to it, but I can't. The scriptures say, the only way you can pay for your sin is you must be perfect. And the Bible uses the word holy, perfect. The Bible says there's no perfect one, no, not one. We try, we feel it. I mean, you don't have to be a parent, but two months just to realize that you do not have to teach your child to do something wrong. You have to teach them what not to do. It's ingrained in their being. Sin has touched them. And we must pay for our sin. I'm not perfect. I'm touched with the taint of sin. What's my penalty? The penalty is that you must pay for your sin, and you can never pay for your sin eternally, so you will be placed in a distance from God. It's a horrible place called hell. No one likes to talk about it, but it's real. It's where there is no peace with God, and there's total distance from God. And that is where mankind stands, hopeless. That's where every single one of us stands. Now, they say when you tell a good story, it's good to leave someone in suspense for a moment. So let me just park you right there. And I want you to think about the reality of that. There is no way your sin can be forgiven, and there's nothing you can do to forgive it. And at that moment, you must pay for your sin, distant from God forever. There is no hope. Unless we find someone to pay for it for us. Well, every mankind needs a human being to pay for their sin, but no human being is perfect. Only God's perfect. So we needed a God-man to forgive us. And that's exactly what God did. He wrapped himself in flesh, came to this earth. We named him Jesus while he was here. He lived a perfect life, God on earth, showing us how to pray to God the Father, showing us how to commune, showing us how to love, showing to teach. And he says, I am going to pay your sin penalty for you because I am a perfect, sinless man. I am God come to earth, incarnate, wrapped in flesh. And if you believe in me, you will not perish but have everlasting life. So I will come to this earth. And he says, now, I'm going to go to the cross. And I'm going to take every sin, every part of that sin element, taint and element in essence on my heart. I'm going to take every sin you've ever done, doing, or going to do. I'm going to place it on my heart, and I will die and receive the pain and the penalty for that sin. And the disciples heard this, and the followers heard this and thought, this is weird. I don't get it. I know I have to pay for my sin, but this is pretty drastic. Now look, so many people, when someone is ill, they say, I wish I could take your pain from you. I say it all the time. As a pastor, I say it all the time. I wish I could take this pain from you. All I can offer is sentiment. I cannot take their pain away. I can give them encouraging truths. I can give them guiding principles in the Bible to get them through. All throughout this last year in the pandemic, do you know that this is the third Easter, the third year? We haven't had a normal Easter in the last 3 years. This is the very first one. For the last 3 years, we have just been giving encouragements to people. As much as I want to take the pain, I cannot. So what's going to be different than Jesus? Well, it's mere sentiment unless he proves that he can keep that promise. That means he's going to have to die for sin. That means he's going to have to take all of our sin. And he's going to die on the cross, and he's going to have to overcome sin and death in order to prove that his salvation is able to save us, or else it's just mere sentiment. He dies on the cross day one. He dies on the cross day two. People are in despair, but on the third day, on the third day, that Sunday morning, they were going to go mourn his body because they forgot all of the promises and memories that they said. And on the third day, the tomb was rolled away, and they said, why do you come seeking him among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. He is risen. The moment he rose from the dead, it didn't save anyone, though. didn't save anyone. The moment he had that miraculous miracle, it did not save any soul. All it did is make salvation, forgiveness available. But the good news is, he said, whoever calls on me and asks me to forgive them of their sin, I will forgive them and wash them whiter than snow. I will take my penalty and I will apply it to their heart, and I will touch the very essence of their being that they could not touch themselves. I will save their soul. You can accept Jesus today. When Jesus was going through his ministry in Matthew 16, verse 13, he asked his followers, he says, who do men say that I am? Who do men say that I am? And they said, well, Jesus, I mean, a lot of people are asking that question. Some say you're a prophet, some say you're Elijah, some say you're, just a good teacher. They like you, nothing against you, they're cool with you. Who do men say that? And then he turned in verse 15 and he said, but who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? That answer changes everything. Because those people who answer that question have experienced the life-altering moment. Who do you say that I am? In history, many people that experienced the power of God, here were their answers. A disgraced woman who God forgave said, come and see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could he possibly be the Christ? Some of his closest friends said, quote, what manner of man is this that the winds and the seas obey him? He's way powerful than what I know. Who do you say that he is? There was an ostracized community that was held prejudiced and biased against the world, and they were troubled by the way people were treating them. They met Jesus, and they said, now we believe, now that we've heard ourselves, we indeed know that he is the Savior of the world. You see, when you know Jesus, you answer that question much differently. Soldier enlisted in the army turned to Jesus and said, surely this man is the Son of God. Who do you say that I am? When you experience Jesus, the answer's different. One of Jesus' family members said, all glory to Jesus. He is able to keep you from falling and bring you away with great joy into the presence of God without a single fault. When you meet Jesus, you answer that question differently. Because there's ultimate life change. A former blasphemer of Christ said this of Jesus, he is the eternal king, the unseen one who never dies. He alone is God. One of Jesus' friends says, he will wipe every tear from every eye. There will be no more death because of him, no more sorrow, no more crying, and no more pain. Jesus had made all of these things go away forever. When you know Jesus, you answer that question differently than someone that doesn't. A former hater says, Jesus is able to do immeasurably more than you can even ask or imagine. And another atheist who turned Christian says, when we are faithless, he remains faithful. A king of a country said, his thoughts are so precious, I can't even number them. If I count them, they're more than number than the sand. Another hater of Jesus turned Christian says, he demonstrated his love for me when I was yet a sinner and had no clue I was. He died for me. And in the simplest words, a young teenage man who experienced Jesus, he says, I don't know who he is, but one thing I do know. Once I was blind, but now I see. Who do you say that he is? Who do you say that he is? I want to give you the opportunity to answer that question as I did myself many years ago, and many people in this room. Many people in this room could share testimonies of life change. We've had people that were successful, have economic peace, political peace, social peace, familial peace, peace of all kinds. But we've had people in this room realize, I was walking around the world perfect, around this world perfect, but I didn't realize I didn't have peace with God. We've had people with shattered homes. We've had people that have committed grotesque sins, and people in this room who have been sinned against, and they have all experienced the salvation of God. Tuesday, we had a young teenager who accepted Christ and told us that, I can't believe the way I'm looking at things new in my life. It's just a really big change. God can change you. Who do you say that he is? I pray on this Easter Sunday you come to the same acknowledgement that we did. He is the Savior of the world, who is the only way to save your sins. Would you bow your head with me as we take the moment for that opportunity for you to accept Christ? Every single person under the sound of my voice, we're so glad that you're here. You are a beautiful creation of God. You are a wonderful person. You are not outside of God's reach. You are not outside of God's reach. But God has saved you or offers his salvation for you, and he will save you. Many of us have come from all storied pasts, and we have taken our cares. We realize that God was not disenchanted with our doubt and our faithlessness. He met our guilt and our shame with great mercy. And if you are not sure beyond a shadow of a doubt that if you were to die today, you would be in heaven with him, God gives you peace on this earth and promises you eternal peace in heaven with him. He gives you perfect fellowship with him now and continues it in heaven. If you are not sure if you were to die today that you would be in heaven, I would ask you, now that you have heard the good news, I want your heart to celebrate about Easter too. In the quietness of your heart, just pray, Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner. I know that I deserve to be punished for my sinfulness. God, all throughout my life, you have not had to tell me I wasn't perfect. I know that. And today I learned that it's because of sin. Jesus, I need you to forgive me. I can't save myself. But I want to tell you in my heart, God, pray this to God. Pray this. Talk to your creator. Talk to your creator right now. Just say, God, I believe that you came to earth. I believe that you are the sinless, perfect Son of God. I believe that what you said, that you took all of my sin and bore it on the cross. And today, I do believe in my heart that you rose again. Jesus, I want to do what I haven't done yet in my life. I accept you as my personal Savior. I accept you as my personal Savior. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me whiter than snow. Touch the areas of my life I could not touch myself. And I praise you. I praise you. In the quietness of this moment, just thank him in your own way. Just thank. Tell him, God, I'm going to need some help now. I don't know a lot about your Bible. I don't know a lot about you. I do know that I needed salvation. You find a good church. This is a good church. There's a lot of good churches out there, but you find a church that will point you to the Bible and surround you with good friends. Lord, I pray that there were people today who will celebrate Easter with us Christians, celebrating your resurrection. I pray that today is the day of their salvation. Bless them for taking the courageous step to put their lives in your hands. Help them now on this journey of life. It's really turbulent. But Lord, would you bless them? Now they have you, the Holy Spirit, living in their hearts, and they talk to them, meditate, speak. Lord, guide them. Bless them. Oh, Lord, in Jesus' name. God's people said, amen. There is a chasm that was between us. It was like a mountain that we couldn't climb. And then in our desperation, we called to heaven, and he pierced the darkness, and he saved our souls. That is the glorious picture of Easter. Let's take a moment to praise him about that truth.
The darkness.
such boundless grace. The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls. Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Alleluia, praise the one who set me free. Alleluia, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Sing that, church.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe out of the silence. The roaring
in your name,
Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Call out to him, church. My God, you are
my living hope.
When you know Jesus, when you know Jesus, you have everything. He is risen. Amen. He is risen. Yes. He is risen. Who do you say that he is? Who do you say that he is? He is the Christ, the Son of the living God. You see, when you know Jesus, you want other people to know Jesus. When you know Jesus, you want other people to know who he is. We have committed our lives to proclaiming who Jesus is. Do you know him? Do you really know him? Because the moment you meet him and the moment you know him, it is a life-altering event, and you are eternally grateful. I'm a pastor. I've committed my life to sharing with people the truth of the good news, but you don't have to be a pastor. All you have to do is be a Christian. Share the good news. I enjoy listening to other pastors. I get edified by their messages and their message of good news. In the 20th century, there was a pastor by the name of S.M. Lockridge who preached his whole life like many of the pastors do, and boy, do I respect and revere the pastors. Near the end of his life, he recalled all of the times he began to minister to people and how much he badly wanted them to know the truth about the resurrection-raised Jesus Christ. I want you to hear the words of a man who wanted you to know who his king is. He says, the Bible says that my king is a sevenfold king. He's the king of the Jews, that's a racial king. He's the king of Israel, that's a national king. He's the king of righteousness, he's the king of the ages, he's the king of heaven, he's the king of glory. He's the king of kings and lord of lords, he says. That's my king, but I wonder, do you know him? No means of measure can define his limitlessness. No far-seeing telescope can bring into visibility the coastline of his shoreless supply. No barrier can hinder him from pouring out his blessing. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. He's impartially merciful. But I wonder, do you know him? He's the greatest phenomena that ever crossed the horizon of this world. He is God's son. He is the sinner's savior. He stands in the solitude of himself. He is awesome and he is unique. He is unparalleled and he's unprecedented. He's the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He is the supreme problem for high criticism. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He is the necessity for spiritual religion. He is the miracle of the ages. He is the superlative of everything good. But I wonder, do you know him? He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tested and tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He strengthens and he sustains. He is God and he died. He heals the sick. He cleanses the leper. He forgives the sinner. He delivers the debtor. He discharges the captive and he defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent and he beautifies the meek. But I wonder, do you know him? His office is manifold. His promise is sure. His light is matchless. His grace is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough for me. His grace is sufficient, and his reign is righteousness, and his yoke is easy, and his burden is light. I wish I could describe him, he says, but he is indescribable. Yes, he's indescribable, he's incomprehensible, he's invincible, and he's irresistible. Well, you can't get him off your mind, and you can't get him off your hands. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. The Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault with him. The witnesses couldn't agree against him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, praise God. The grave couldn't hold him. Amen, that's my king. Thine is the kingdom, thine is the power, thine is the glory, forever and ever.
Come Jesus Amen. From the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the Holy.
child.